So let's talk about what's our role as a security professional. And what we're going to do in this discussion, in this section, is discuss what security role now, what are we presently being asked to do, what may we be asked to do, and then starting to look towards pandemic planning in general in the future. So what's our current role in this situation? Security professionals are typically the ones that people are turning to when they want to discuss preparedness, when they want to discuss response, when they want to discuss risk management or crisis management in general. We're the subject matter experts that people come to. And that even occurs in situations when it's a medical incident. And this is not something that you typically think about security being involved in, but we are the individuals that I'd say have the know-how, have the framework, have the experience to be able to respond on behalf of our organizations to protect our people. So what are some of the tasks that security professionals are being asked to do right now? I'll start off with updating on travel disruptions and restrictions. So mobility is a major consideration for organizations. We're seeing this a lot, not only with just where can people travel to when can people come back, but also who are we letting in our buildings now? That's becoming a big issue now as organizations put in even more stringent travel restrictions, not only on domestic travel, on international travel, but also domestically. And even getting to the point of, the business continuity plans and who are we letting into our buildings and who are we not. Adherence to local directives. And this could be, simple directives that come out from, local health and safety professionals all the way to directives coming out saying that there needs to be N95 masks, respirator masks supplied to individuals to walk around. Activating and updating business continuity plans, having clear escalation triggers and reviewing these. A lot of situations we have organizations that where security is owning that business continuity protocol. Accommodating quarantines. Quarantines, obviously, people are being checked in on isolation, just someone being alone, and typically we're seeing that right now for 14-day periods. Remote work options, individuals coming back from areas where there has been an infection, or where more planning needs to be done for worst-case scenarios. Cancellation of events, increase in virtual meetings, similar to remote options. Security working to find different ways for us to decrease our footprint. Closely monitoring the situation and generally, having that good intelligence capability to be able to talk about what has happened and what hasn't happened. International SOS, we work in travel risk management. I can't tell you the number of rumors that my clients called me with right after Wuhan about the next place that was going to close down or what they were hearing. Having a good, reliable monitoring source is critical. Security professionals know where to find that. Others oftentimes don't. And then other duties, and this could be distributing PPE to employees in high-risk locations or just being part of that procurement process in general. At this point, we're going to talk about pandemic planning in general. So one of the questions that's already rolled in came in and said, can I use my flu pandemic plan to approach COVID-19? The answer, absolutely. In general, my recommendation to organizations and security professionals is to plan generally for pandemics. That doesn't mean that your response is going to be general, but having a plan for pandemics, that plan should be general. Pandemics are going to look different. Dr. Disraelly talked about MERS, talked about SARS, seasonal influenza. There's plenty of similarities when we see coronaviruses, but they're going to come up differently. They're going to come from different locations. Their spread is going to be different. We can't have a plan that is just planned out for COVID-19. And then when COVID-2022 comes up, we're trying to figure out what to do because it's very different. Plan generally with your pandemic plans, develop a framework, and from there execute on that framework and use that framework to deal with that current crisis that you're doing now. What are the things that we need to be able to do? Leverage intelligence collection capabilities to monitor and determine what your actions are going to be. This is really critical. Monitoring is an absolute must. I'm seeing it when I'm visiting my clients right now. that I've seen the same dashboards that are up that you're seeing in our presentations today. Go with what you know. Don't go with the rumors. Have a critical understanding of what's happening around you. If there are buildings that are having cases where someone is infected, what's the local impact on transportation, on communications? What's the current status of your emergency services? And then finally, you know, looking at the triggers for escalation and de-escalation in these types of situations. Security professionals are excellent at saying, okay, what now? What next? So we've taken this action. What's our next action? That's something that you need to be thinking about for what's going to happen next. Now, working with your crisis communications team, there's a lot of messaging that needs to happen. There's a lot of messaging that's already happening. One of my recommendations is to pre-script a lot of that. We're talking about some of the best practices on the back end on lessons learned, but I'd like to make sure that I reinforce this. Take the things that you're doing now for dealing with this pandemic, make that your template for dealing with the next one. If you want to look for pre-scripted messaging, look at what you're doing now. Save those, take those away so that when you're in a situation where you're dealing with a future pandemic, at least you have a starting place, and that's going to make a lot of the difference when we're dealing with a crisis situation. All right, next up, leveraging networks and liaising with your critical providers to receive affected personnel for care. If you do have individuals that may need to go into quarantine, do you have the providers? Do you have the building? Do you have the infrastructure to support that? Work with third-party providers who are able to support you in everything that you need. And that could be everything from your employee assistance programs all the way to working with PR firms should there be a situation where your organization is impacted by and you're shutting down a building, you're shutting down a site, brick and mortar is impacted, something of that nature, and you do have to make that communication. And then determining what your posture is to respond, how this may impact your business operations and generally being able to communicate about that to the organization and being able to say, this is how we can respond, this is how we cannot respond, this is how much we can do, and this is what we're seeing from, a longer-term perspective, not just the short-term of the next 72 hours, but the medium and eventually the long-term impacts.